So how are you guys today? How has been your Comic-Con experience so far?
I'll start since I have a microphone in my hand. Yeah, sure. It's been great. It's been a long day, but we've, you know, as usual, it's always mind-boggling when you see the amount of fans that are in that ballroom. And, you know, I saw out my hotel window last night, people lining up. I thought, that can't be for Korra. And then I find out they started lining up yesterday at noon.
Oh, yeah.
Which is just insane. So, and then we got to meet all the fans. So we're a little tired, but it's been a blast as usual. And I'll let Janet speak now.
Yeah.
I obviously agree with everything that David said. And the other thing I would say is just like the panels are so fun for us because we get to see stuff we would never normally see. You know, it's not like we're hanging out at Nickelodeon watching Mike and Brian illustrate. So when they always go the extra mile with the panels. They always come up with like some really cool concept. They always share a lot of stuff that I don't think fans of other shows get to see. You know, they show behind the scenes stuff. We all sang. We got to see an episode that we hadn't seen. Yeah. So
is this a deleted episode? Or is it a future episode that's coming out?
A future episode that people got a sneak peek at.
So it's kind of a little treat for you guys.
Yeah. It's always.
It was cool.
Nice. What's great about The Legend of Korra is that there is such a wide range in the fandom that's out there. I myself got into it because I was watching it with my nephew when I was babysitting, and I'm like, this is awesome.
We've heard that a lot today, by the way. A lot of parents going, I didn't want to watch it at first. My kid made me watch it, and I love it now.
Yeah. I even have my parents watching it now, so it's like a whole family affair. But have you guys encountered any crazed fans, any crazy fan stories?
Well, I think we do still get, and I always feel so like it's not my place to accept that kind of adulation in a sense, because the real geniuses behind the production, of course, are Mike and Brian. And so they're the ones that create this whole world that we just get to kind of step into and be a part of. But we will definitely get people who, you know, of course, we have great, great cosplayers because the costumes are so amazing on the show, and people who've, you know, been affected by the show on a deeper level. And sometimes they're nervous and sometimes they cry, and it feels like such an honor to, you know, elicit that kind of a response from fans. Yeah,
right.
It's such a privilege.
Well, recently there was a kind of a little bit of a shakeup, but it wasn't too scary. Although when we heard that the book 3, all of those episodes were going to go online, I feel like there was a little bit of fan concern. What can you say to kind of quell that concern?
I think, just going off of what I've heard Brian and Mike saying all day, I'll just copycat what they said. But, you know, basically the show has a giant following online and always has, and that's how it's really started out. And they kind of, last minute, Nickelodeon was like, you know, put it on a time slot that may or may not work there. But right now, our fans are always have been online, so nothing's changing. Season 4 is already written and done and is in post-production now. So everything's the same except... You know, it'll be nick.com and those things. So.
Right. Well, you brought up season 4. What can you tell us, if anything, about the upcoming season?
I don't think we're allowed to say anything.
If I could remember, I still wouldn't be able to say anything. We shoot them so far in advance, it's hard to keep track of what's going on.
When did you guys film season 4?
We finished recording it like last year, even, or the beginning of this year or something.
Oh, wow.
We've been done recording the last episodes for a while now.
Was the season 4 even confirmed last year?
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, they've had 4 seasons confirmed for a really long time.
Very nice.
And book 4 is awesome, by the way. And the finale of this season is ridiculous.
Yeah, it really just keeps building. It's amazing.
Well, speaking of this season, I feel like I was really happy to see the 4 prisoners and that whole storyline developing. I feel like they've kind of been, they're a little bit on par with more of Amon from the first season and getting like the fans' blood pumping again with really interesting villains.
Yes.
Can you talk about that story arc moving forward from where we are in book 3?
I'm also fascinated by that. It's just so dramatic and intense, these villains, you know. But I'll just say I'm a giant Henry Rollins fan, and Henry Rollins is voicing Zaheer. And so that's, you know, to me that was the coolest thing. And so I'm a giant fan of that storyline.
Nice.
Yeah, I think, we really don't like to give many spoilers, but just speaking to the development of those characters, I think Mike and Brian were talking earlier today about how they liked the idea of sort of having that shadow version of our team Avatar. You know, you have this sort of evil firebender, evil metalbender, evil waterbender who has arms as water or vice versa.
Right.
And that that I think that's a really great point that you made, which is sort of when you have that sort of mirror image, but it's like the dark side of it, it really does like rile people up because it feels so close to home. It's sort of the twisted version of what you've come to love and be loyal to.
Right. Well, I think what's great about all of the intertwining storylines with The Legend of Korra is that they're mysteriously all connected with each other. So is there some sort of tie that you can sort of tease for us between the prisoners escaping for mysterious reasons and then what's going on in the Earth Kingdom with the Earth Queen?
Can I pose that question one more time?
Yeah. So I was just saying that there are like multiple storylines always kind of intertwine in this series. And so we have what's going on with the prisoners and then we have what's going on with the Earth Queen.
Right.
Are they somehow mysteriously connected?
Yeah, I don't know how to say anything. They're right over that wall.
They're like, no. Yeah.
Sorry about that.
Laser pointer on your heads already.
Yeah, exactly.
Understandable. Well, what can you
guys...
But
then again, we've recorded everything, so they can't fire us. So what it is...
and that's where it cuts out mysteriously. Well, what can you guys tell us about the Earth Queen and that whole storyline and her kind of ambitions?
The Earth Queen, well... You know, I always go back to the booth and you know, the actress that played it. I can't remember her name off the top of my head, but she was great. And she brought a lot of life to that character. But, you know, in the end, she ended up being not so nice, right?
Right.
And I don't know if she comes back or not, to be quite honest with you, if we see her again. We may. I don't remember right now.
So my last question, and I've been kind of... This is kind of a personal question of mine, then. Do you... Real life Mako. Do you have a Mako scarf and do you wear it all the time?
Do I have a Mako scarf and I wear it all the time? I have a secret Mako scarf, but now he's given it to his grandma, so I can't really wear it out because I've already given it to my grandma.
Right. What is your version then of, in your own kind of repertoire in real life, what's your version of the Mako scarf?
My version of the Mako scarf?
Yeah.
It's just my baseball hat pulled down low.
Yeah.